الجزء اللي هنشرحه النهاردة هو شابتر 3 الخاص بـ Diagnosing the Organization أو تشخيص المشكلات التي تعاني منها المنظمات واللي بيتطلب منها إن هي تبدأ عملية التطوير والتغيير التنظيمي. What is diagnosis? Diagnosis means that I want to know the causes of the problems that the organization is suffering from. That is why the organization in the last step that we explained in the last lecture decided to allow an organizational change agent, organizational development change agent to enter into the organization and to collect data, preliminary data to initially diagnose what is the problem of the organization. However, after developing a contract with the organizational development specialist, his task now in this stage is to diagnose or to identify the main causes of the problems that we have previously identified. What are the goals of the diagnosis process? The goals are summarized into three main goals. Number one is to identify the organizational issues or the causes of the problems that the organization is suffering from. Number two is to allow the organizational development specialist to collect as much data as possible in order to analyze this data and to accurately specify the root cause of the problems. Because if we identify the root cause of the problem, then suggesting the solutions or the change interventions, the developmental efforts will be successful. The diagnosis process is considered a complex process because it includes humans, and any process that includes humans is complex. Why? Because the OD will have to interact with the organizational members, and especially if the OD is an external change agent, he's not one who is working currently within the organization, then in order to establish this kind of interaction and collaboration between the OD and the organizational members, this process might take some time. The organizational members may not open up so easily to the organizational development specialist at the beginning of the process. They might not be willing to speak freely about the problems that they are facing within their organization and about the real causes for these problems, and that's why the diagnosis process is considered a very complex process. As we mentioned before, the organizational development specialist should have these kind of interpersonal skills and this charismatic personality that will help me to gain the trust and the collaboration of the organizational members, because they will help me on identifying the problems of the organization. It is also complex because it does not only identify the main problems, but also needs the collaboration of the organization members to suggest what they see as appropriate solutions for these problems, or what they see as an applicable and convenient solution that most of the organizational members will be welcoming implementing these kind of solutions for the problems they perceive within the organizational environment. So developing the mutual understanding between the OD specialist and the organizational member and encouraging positive behaviors on both sides is a very complex process. In order to make the diagnosis process easy, scientists developed conceptual frameworks or models in order to guide the audio specialists and the organization members on how to find the root cause of the problems within the organizations. These kind of models would point out to the areas within the organization that should be examined and the people that should be asked in order to identify the main problems and the causes of the problems that the organization is currently suffering from. In this chapter, we are going to view two diagnostic models. The first one is the open system model, and the second is the comprehensive diagnostic model. The open system model perceives the organization as a system that is or that consists of a number of subsystems integrated together into one whole. The open system model also suggests that the organization is operating within an external environment and that there are a number of interactions that happens between the organization and its external environment through the inputs. The organization gets its inputs from the external environment. These inputs might be the technology, the people, the materials, and then the inputs are operated on within the organization in order to produce the goods or services. And then these goods and services are delivered to the external environment, whom are different customers and consumers. And there is an important process that happens when the outputs are delivered to the external environment, which is the feedback through which the organization will recognize whether or not it was successful in meeting the expectations of the external stakeholders, so the customers and the consumers, and to get their feedback on the disadvantages or the weak points in the services and the goods that it has produced, which will help in changing the process or changing the kind of inputs that are entering the organization in order to enhance the quality and to meet the needs of the external consumers. The open system model consists of the environment in which the organization is operating. This organizational environment is anything beyond the boundaries of the organization. And it consists of a number of factors or forces that can directly or indirectly affect the operations and the performance of the organization, such as the political stability of the system, the economic conditions, the social and cultural factors, the needs and expectations of the stakeholders and the customers, the unions, the technology that is available in the external environment. All these kinds of forces have direct or indirect effects on performance outcomes of the organization. In the open system, the organizations and the people are continuously exchanging information and resources between the organization and the external environment. And it is very, very important when we diagnose the problems of the organization to take into consideration the external forces that might affect the problematic outcomes that we see in the performance of the organization. The open system also consists of the inputs that comes into the organization in order to be transformed to the goods and services that the organization will deliver to the external environment once more. These inputs might consist of the human resources, the information, the energy, the money, the technology, and these inputs, and the organization depends on the external environment in securing these kinds of inputs in order to transform them into goods and services. It is worth noting that the transformation process to convert the inputs into outputs is composed of both the social and the technological components. So the technological component here involves the tools, the equipment, the technology that will be used in order to transform the inputs into the goods and services. However, this process will not be totally successful unless we focus on the social interactions and the human behaviors that are taking place within the organization, because they also have an important effect on the success of the organization in delivering these goods or services with the right quality, the right cost, in the right time to the customers in the external environment. So the transformation process should be considered on both the social and the technological component, not just the technological component. The other parts of the open system are the outputs, and the outputs here are the transformed inputs into the goods and the services that the consumers and the customers will consume in the external environment. There is also the boundaries, which means the distinction between the system, the organization as system, and the external environment in which it operates. When we talk about a closed system, we here mean that this kind of boundary is totally closed, meaning that there is no interaction between the organization and its external environment. However, when these boundaries are permeable, as in the feeder, they are dotted, this means that the spaces available in the boundaries allows the interaction between the organization, the system, and its external environment. In the open system, there is also the feedback, which is the information that the organization gathers in the external environment about its actual performance, about the quality of its products and services, about the satisfaction of the customers, about its financial performance, in order to know whether or not it has achieved its objectives, and what are the problems that have caused the organization to be poor in such areas. So feedback is very, very important in order to adapt to the external environment. And there is also in the open system model the alignment. The alignment here means the overall interaction and fit between the different parts of the organization as a system, and the fit between the organization and its external environment. So as long as there is a high fit between the different subsystems within the organization, between the input and the transformation process, between the different parts of the transformation process, between the transformation process and the quality and the quantity and the time in which the outputs are produced, and there is also a fit between what the organization produces and what the external environment expects or needs from the organization, then this system will be successful and vice versa. The other model that we will talk about in details is the comprehensive diagnosis model. And in this model, we will try to diagnose the organization on three levels: the organizational level, the group level, and the individual level. And the key success to diagnose at each level is to know what are you looking for at each level. In the comprehensive diagnosis model, we see three levels: organizational level, group level, and individual level. And at each level, there are inputs, design components, and outputs. And we will be discussing each level in detail. In the last figure, we saw that the external environment is considered the key input to diagnosing the organizational level. So the external environment with its direct and indirect forces will help us to diagnose the problems at the organizational level. Then, at the group level, we will find that the organization design will be an input for the group level, and at the individual level, we will find that the organization design and the group design will be the inputs for the job or the individual level diagnosis. These kind of interrelationships suggest that there should be a fit between the different components and the different levels within the organization in order to successfully achieve the objective and in order to successfully determine the problems within each level. At the organizational diagnosis level, there are inputs which are generally divided into the general environment and the industry structure. There is also the transformation of the design components, in which the inputs that are coming from the external environment are transformed using the technology, the structure, the strategy, the vision, the mission of the organization, the human resources with their skills and behaviors within the organization, and the measurement systems that are used within the organization. All these are the components of the transformation processes that take place within the organization, and maybe the problem that the organization suffers from is in one of those components. And then there is the outputs of the organization, which are usually measured in the organizational effectiveness through productivity, through stakeholders' satisfaction. And we will see that usually the problems that appear in the output are the key to diagnose other problems in the transformation and the input. So usually the diagnosis begins by the outputs and then goes back to the transformation and the inputs on the organizational level or on the group level or on the individual level. So for example, the organization will notice that there is a decrease in the satisfaction of the customers, or a decrease in the productivity, or a decrease in the shareholders' profits. So this will make the organization to dig deep in order to diagnose what's the problem within the organization. Transformation processes, either in the strategy, the policies, the technology used, the communication within the structure, and also they might search for the problem in their external environment. So the two key inputs at the organizational level are at the general environment or the general forces that usually affect all of the organization operating in this community or this environments such as the economic factors, the political factors, the social and cultural factors, while the task environment or industry structure is the specific industry in which or sector in which the organization is operating, like the health sector, the educational sector. These are the task. These are the task environments in which the organizations are operating. Also, the organization transformation process, in which the inputs are transformed into the goods and services targeted to the customers in the external environment, and also how the organization design its structure, its communication channels, its operations, which is called the design components. Both of them combined together, is called the strategic orientation of the organization. The task environment in which the organization operates is defined by five forces. Number one is the supplier power, the suppliers of the organization who supplies materials, technology, might affect the performance of the organization, specifically the financial performance and the quality of the goods and services that it provides through the prices and the quality of inputs that it supplies to the organization. So, suppliers should be thoroughly studied to know their effect, the positive or negative effect on the organizational performance. Number two, there are also the powerful buyers. Retailers such as Walmart, Costco, who buys from the organization in order to sell the goods to the customers in the external environment, might also have this kind of power over our organization. So they might ask for reductions in the prices in order to sell our products to the customers with lower prices or in certain promotional ways that help them to enhance their performance. So we also have to study the strengths and the weaknesses of our buyers, the people who buy our products. We also have to study the threats of new firms entering into the competition, entering into the markets in which our organization is operating, because usually when they enter into the market, we will notice that there is a decrease in our market share, especially if they are entering into the market with a cost leadership strategy, meaning they are entering into the market with lower prices for the same product that we are providing to our customers. Also, we have to take into consideration the threat of new products or services that existing companies within our environment can produce and which will compete with our existing products or services. Finally, we have to be very cautious about the rivalry among existing competitors. If we have too many companies that compete within the same market for the same number of customers, then unfortunately this might affect the performance of the organization, since the competition would be very fierce, and if you are not performing effectively within the market, then you might notice a decrease in your market share due to this fierce competition. The environment in which the organization is operating can heavily influence its performance, as we mentioned before. We should characterize this environment along two main dimensions. Number one is information uncertainty, which is the degree to which the organization can get transparent and enough information about its performance from the external environment. The degree of uncertainty and the degree of risk of not having clear and accurate information from the external environment might heavily affect the performance of the organization. The environment that is rapidly changing or continuously changing, like the globalized world that we are working in today, would heavily affect the performance and the processes within any organization. Also, the second dimension is the resource dependency, which is the degree to which an organization relies on other organizations to get its resources. These resources might be the materials, the technology, the information, the financial resources. So, whenever the organization is heavily dependent on other external organizations, external environment to get its resources, then we might expect that this environment will have a significant effect on the performance of the organization. At the organizational level, the second component of our diagnosis process at the organizational level is the design component. And the design component consists of five major dimensions. The first dimension is the strategy. The strategy is the pathway that the organization will choose in order to achieve its objectives. The components of the strategy are the mission, the vision, the strategic objectives, the kind of strategy that the organization will focus on in order to achieve those objectives, such as diversification strategy, cost leadership strategy. Number two, the components of the design component is the technology, which is how the organization is going to convert its inputs to products and services. So the technology represents a major part of the transformation processes within the organization. It includes production methods, the workflow, the equipment and tools used. And number three is the structural system, which describes how attention and resources are focused on task accomplishment. The structural system is very, very important because it shows the organizational members how the overall work of the organization is divided into subunits and on different levels and individuals within the organization. And it also shows the communication channels and the authority lines and the coordination that will happen between the different subunits within the organization in order to achieve the goals effectively using the organizational technology. So the structural system will focus on how the organization will structure itself, how it is going to organize itself into different subunits or departments. Each department will have these types of tasks that, when are accomplished or achieved, will help the organization in achieving its overall strategic goals. We should here stress on the coordination and collaboration and fit and flexibility that should be present between the different subunits within the organization. The fourth component is the measurement system. The measurement systems are the methods that are used within the organization to gather, assess, and transfer information about the different activities of the groups and individuals within the organization, which will help to assess and know how the organization is performing. this component is very important because without this system of measuring, we will not know whether or not the organization is achieving its strategic objectives. We will not know what are our weak points and what are our strength points, so we could work on both of them to enhance the performance of the organization. The fifth component is the human resource systems, which is also a significant component in the transformation process within the organization. So we always say that the human resources are the most important asset within the organization, because if I have all the other inputs, other things like the technology, the financial resources, the materials, but I don't have the talented worker who could use all these components together in order to produce a quality good or service, then the organization will not be successful. So the human resource system within the organization, which includes such mechanisms as recruiting, selecting, appraising, training the employees, is a very important system, transformation system that helps the organization in choosing the right person, putting the right person in the right place, helping the person to use his skills and talents to help the organization achieve its aims and objectives. The last component of the organizational level that uses in the design component is the organizational culture, which is also a very important component. And you might find that the problem that the organization is suffering from and affecting its performance lies in a negative organizational culture and organizational climate within the organization. This culture represents the basic ethics, assumptions, and values and norms of the organizational members. So if these assumptions and values and norms are positive, then the organization will perform effectively, and on the contrary, if they are negative, then the organizational members will usually be counterproductive, and the organization will not be able to achieve its objectives and will suffer from many problems. The last component of the organizational level diagnosis is the outputs. We should focus on diagnosing the outputs of the organization through measuring its performance. So we have to measure the performance related to the financial outputs, such as the profits, the return on investment, and the earnings per share. We should also focus on measuring the productivity of the organization, because it reflects the efficiency of the organization in using its resources. And we should also focus on measuring the stakeholder satisfaction, which reflects how well the organization has met the expectations and needs of the different groups within its external environment. So, for example, customer satisfaction can be measured in terms of market share, and employee satisfaction can be measured in terms of an opinion survey. Investor satisfaction can be measured in terms of stock price and or analyst opinion. So we have to focus on analyzing the outputs of the organization, the financial ones, the productivity and the satisfaction of the stakeholders, because in these areas we might find some problems, and we should diagnose the reasons for these problems, which, as I said before, might reflect problems in the transformation processes or in the inputs from the general environment or the task environment of the organization. The next level of diagnosis is the group level, and as we see in the figure, the group level inputs comes from the organizational design, meaning that على مستوى الجروب, علشان أبدأ أعمل عملية الدايجنوزز, الانبوتس بتاعتي على مستوى الجروبس أو الديبارتمنتس within the organization هيجيلي منين؟ هيجيلي من الطريقة اللي المنظمة قررت إن هي تستركتشر اتسلف, الستركتشر العام بتاعها, هيجيلي من التكنولوجي that the organization decided to use, هيجيله من الهيومن ريسورس سيستم، لان اعضاء الجروب دول جولي من خلال السيستم اللي تم تصميمه على مستوى الاورجنايزيشن at the organizational level من خلال عمليه السيلكشن وعمليه التدريب وعمليه الانترفيوينج وغيرها. فاذا على مستوى الجروب الانبوتس دايما هتجيلي من خلال الترانسفورميشن او الديزاين كومبوننت على مستوى الاورجنايزيشن. اوكي طيب نيجي بقى للجزء الثاني اللي هو الديزاين كومبوننت، وده هيتكون من مجموعه من العناصر. الديزاين كومبوننت على مستوى الجروب، سو ان اوردر فور اني جروب تو ورك افكتيفلي، what are the dimensions that will define the efficiency of any group or the effectiveness of any group? It is the goal clarity, the way the team is functioning, the group norms and values and ethics, and the group composition and the task structure of the group. And we will explain each one of them in details. And then at the output level, we will find that the outputs of the team are measured through the effectiveness. Sorry, the quality of work life and the performance of the team. Now we will explain the design component at the group level. In the design component, we should focus on five major design components, which are the goal clarity, the task structure, the goal, group composition, team functioning, and performance norms. A group clarity means how well the group members understand the goals that they are assigned to accomplish. These goals should have such characteristics such as being able to be measured. They should be timed. Should have a time frame to accomplish. They should be a little bit challenging, very specific and clear. And then the second component is the task structure, which is concerned with how the group work is designed. It can vary along two key dimensions, which is the coordination dimension and the regulation dimension. The coordination dimension is related to how the tasks of the different members within the groups are structured in a way that promotes an effective and a flexible flow of interaction among the group among the group members. This kind of coordination is very important because it will facilitate the work of the group members and will help them to achieve the goals assigned to them in the defined time frame. The regulation dimension, it involves the degree to which the members can control or have a control over the different thoughts and the behavior and their behaviors in order to achieve the organizational objectives, meaning how much freedom, how much empowered they feel over the project we have at hand, how much the supervisor do not interfere, or the direct measure do not interfere in the work of the group members until they finish the task assigned to them. So the regulation dimension is related to the authority that the group members have over their work, whether they are tightly controlled or they have a lot of freedom in working together, in putting the plans, in putting the deadlines, in order to achieve the goals assigned to them. The group composition is concerned with the membership of individuals within the groups. So the members of the groups can differ on many dimensions, which will have a significant effect on the group behavior, such as the age, the education, the experience and the skills and the abilities. All of these factors would significantly affect how the people behave and interact with each other within the group, and might be a source of problems within some groups within the organization. So if we talk about the problem of ages, is using the presence of two or more generations of employees within the organization. So there is the X generation, the Y generation, and the Z, or the millennials. So there are different types of educational background, of social and cultural and ethical values, and different levels of experiences and skills. So this might, if not managed well, elicit a lot of problems and conflict between individuals within the same group, since they are different in their social backgrounds or in their ages or their work experience and skills. The last dimension of the design component at the group level is the performance norms, which are the beliefs of the group members about how they should perform collectively together, and what are the levels of performance that they aspire to achieve. So it includes the values, the norms, the ethics that the group members should focus on in order to work effectively together and achieve the assigned goals. The last component at the group level design is the outputs, and the outputs of the group level can be measured on two dimensions: the performance and quality of work life. Performance is usually measured through the ability of the team members to reduce the costs, increase the productivity, or increase the quality of their performance. And the other dimension is the quality of work life, which is concerned with how the group members are satisfied with working for this organization, how well the team members are interacting, collaborating, and the team is strongly cohesive together, and how well the organizational members are committed to continue working for this organization. You might find at the group level that there are problems in either in the performance, like the cost or the productivity of the team members, or in their satisfaction and commitment toward the organization, which will refer to other problems in the design components, such as the group clarity or the team composition, and it might also refer to some problems at the organizational design.